But if you turn your Bibles to Acts chapter 12, you know what we're going to look at today in this narrative story of Peter being rescued from prison is we're going to look at how prayer, what? That's our phrase around here. Prayer changes things. Interesting, if you go around Lexington right now, you'll notice there's a number of signs everywhere. I was at CVS the other day getting cough drops, and there's a big old orange sign on the fence of CVS, and it says, prayer changes things. I'm going, how'd that get there? I didn't put that there. That's one of our signs. And I found out from Heidi, when Peggy Brown came to be the speaker from a women's conference, so one thing she asked her, Heidi, is, I want a rental car. Heidi didn't understand at first because Heidi's going to pick her up, drive her wherever she needed to go, but she wanted her own rental car. Heidi found out later, when Peggy Brown comes to a city to speak at a conference, Peggy Brown is the wife of the founder of U-Turn for Christ. She's from California. And whenever she comes to a city that she's going to speak at, she gets a rental car because she takes these prayer changes things signs and she brings them all over the town that she's speaking in and she zip ties them to fences all over the town. And so when you're around Lexington, look for our orange signs that are zip-tied around all the different places around town saying prayer, what? Changes things. And it does. And we're going to see that today in this story of Peter being rescued. Prayer changes things. It's amazing. And we're going to see five ways that prayer changes things through this story of Peter. And we're going to see here, prayer is incredibly powerful and it changes things. We're told that in Scripture, by the way, too. James 5:16 tells us that in King James Version, it says, the effectual prayer of a righteous man, what? Availeth much. NIV Version translates that, the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. NASB, my version, says this, the effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. Jesus put it this way, Matthew 7:7-8. Ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened. For everyone who asks receives, everyone who seeks finds, and everyone who knocks, the door shall be opened. I like what Jesus said in John 16:24. He said, until now, you ask for nothing in my name. Ask and you receive so that your joy may be made full. And then James, the brother of Jesus, put it this way. Sometimes, James 4:2, sometimes you do not have because what? You don't ask. I really believe sometimes heaven is just waiting for us to pray. And as soon as we pray, you go, oh, they're praying. Time to answer those prayers. And I don't know how that works with the sovereignty of God. I'm not going to try to figure it out. I just know that prayer changes things. It changes things. So let's look at five ways this morning from the story in Acts chapter 12, five ways that prayer changes things. Let's jump right in, Acts 12, verse 1. If you're there, say amen. Here we go. Now about that time, Herod the king laid hands on some who belonged to the church in order to mistreat them. And he had James, the brother of John, put to death with a sword. And when he saw that it pleased the Jews, he proceeded to arrest Peter also. Now it was during the days of unleavened bread, and when he had seized Peter, he put him in prison, delivering him to four squads of soldiers to guard him, intending after the Passover to bring him out before the people. So Peter was kept in the prison, but notice, prayer for Peter was being made fervently by the church to God. And on that very night, when Herod was about to bring him forward, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, guards in front of the door, and they were watching over the prison. Now, let's go over that a little bit. Herod. Now, there's five different Herods in the New Testament. This Herod is Herod Agrippa I. Now, Herod was a half-Jew. He was ruling over this area of Israel, and he wanted to gain favor with the full Jews because they kind of looked at him as a half-breed. And so this Herod was from, talk about a dysfunctional family. The Herods were very dysfunctional. His grandpa was Herod the Great. Herod the Great was the one that when the wise men came through and they were being led by a star to the king of the Jews, he told Herod the Great, the grandpa of this guy, told the wise men, he said this, hey, when you find the king of the Jews, because he thought he was the king of the Jews, he said, when you find the king of the Jews, let me know where he's at so I could worship him too. And he wasn't going to worship him. He was going to kill him. And so the wise men found Jesus in Bethlehem, worshiped Jesus as in his infancy there. But then they were warned by a dream to don't go back to Herod, just get out of town. Herod then eventually found out that they didn't come back with him where Jesus was at. So what did Herod do? He found out that Bethlehem was the place the Messiah was to be born. So he killed all the kids, 2 years old and younger, trying to eradicate Jesus Christ. Talk about a dysfunctional family. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree. Now this grandson kills the first apostle who is to be martyred, and that's James. Who's James? James is the brother of John. Remember they were the sons of Zebedee? What was their nickname? Do you remember? Sons of Thunder. They had black leather jackets that said Sons of Thunder on the back. No, I'm just kidding. Maybe their sandals said it or something. I don't know. But they were sons of thunder, right? And they were, it was Peter, James, and John were part of the inner three disciples of Jesus Christ. They were the three closest disciples and friends of Jesus. And so this Herod, Agrippa, arrests one of the main leaders, main disciples of Jesus, and has him killed by the sword. What does that mean? He was probably beheaded by Herod. Now notice, as this happens, he gains favor with the Jews, so what's he do next? Well, I kill one of the main leaders, James, let's kill the next, Peter, the rock, let's kill him next. Gets him in jail, but he can't kill him because it's the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. What does that mean? It means there's a week-long feast going up to Passover, and during the feast, it wasn't right for Jews to be executing anybody. They waited till after the feast. So now Peter's in prison for a week, awaiting his own execution. And question, as he's awaiting his own execution, probably to be beheaded like his good friend James was, what's Peter doing? Is he knocking his cup of water against him? Let me out of here! What's Peter doing? Look at the scriptures. What's Peter doing? He's sleeping. I don't know if I'd be sleeping the night before I'm about to have my head cut off. Well, one thing is Peter was known for sleeping. He was. What did he do when he was brought up to the Mount of Transfiguration to see Jesus transfigured? Jesus is literally talking to Moses and Elijah, and what's Peter doing? He's sleeping. He's brought to the Garden of Gethsemane, and Jesus says, hey, watch and pray. Your spirit is willing, but your flesh is weak. What did Peter do? Three different times. Sleeping. The guy liked to sleep. But there was another reason why I think he was sleeping. Because the church was praying. And there was a supernatural peace upon his life as the church prayed for him. And he just was at rest, even though he's going to face possibly being, you know, his head cut off the next day. That's the first thing, the way prayer changes things, by the way. Prayer changes things, number one, because it provides peace even in the midst of a crisis. It does. Paul put it this way, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And as you pray, instead of stressing, as you pray, the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, will guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. Peter actually wrote about this in his epistle, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 7. He says, hey, do this. Cast all your anxiety upon God. How do you do that? Through prayer. Because he cares for you. Amen? We had a major crisis in the church this week. One of my best friends in the church, one of the elders of the church, lost his 22-year-old son this week. Major crisis. In church, we need to be praying for the Osterhaus family because they're in the midst of it, of loss, mourning. We had over 800 people on campus yesterday celebrating the life of Luke. Over 800 people. It was a wonderful celebration of his life, but that's not going to make the pain go away. And one of the things we could be doing for the Osterhaus family right now, pray for them. Pray for a supernatural peace and comfort upon their lives. And pray that God would be the shepherd who carries them through this valley right now. Because prayer changes things. The first way that prayer changes things is through providing a supernatural peace in the midst of crisis. The antidote to stress is prayer. And prayer changes things because it'll give you a peace, even in the midst of a storm. It's amazing. So Peter's sleeping, church is praying. Let's look what happens now. Verse 7. And behold, an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared, verse 7, and a light shone in the cell, and he struck Peter's side, roused him. It's like, Peter, get up, man, quickly. Get up. I used to sing to my kids, it's Keith Green's song, when they wouldn't wake up for chores on Saturday morning. Jesus rose from the dead, and you can't even get out of bed. Flip the lights on. That's what this angel's doing right now. It's like, get up, Peter. Quit sleeping. Time to get you out of jail, man. Get up quickly. And his chains, what did they do? He's rescued. His chains fell off. Here's the second way that prayer changes things. Prayer changes things, first of all, by providing a supernatural peace in the midst of crisis. Prayer changes things, secondly, by providing deliverance to those who are being prayed for. See the picture there? Church is praying, and the chains come off supernaturally. Church, there's a lot of people that you probably know that have chains. They're in bondage or something. We sang about it this morning. They might be an addiction, might be a waywardness, might be they're lost, and they're in the bondage of sin. You know what the greatest thing you could do for them? To rescue them, to get the chains to fall off? Pray for them. We could have an hour up here this morning of open mic, and there'd be testimony of the 300-plus people that are here right now, and you could give testimony after testimony of how you were stuck in sin, and you were in bondage to sin, and you got set free because someone was praying for you. Remember when it happened to me? 40-plus years ago, 1978, I was stuck in sin. I wasn't just lost. I was lost. I was stuck in immorality. I was stuck in addiction already, drunkenness every weekend. I was stuck. And there's a group of Young Life kids in my high school, and they started praying for me. And they were praying for me. And you know what? I got set up by their prayers, man. After they started praying for me, it seems like every other corner I would turn, someone was witnessing to me. And there was divine appointments, and there was just power of God pulling me into his kingdom through the prayers of God's people. And it took the chains off, and I got saved and set free. Who do you need to do that for? Don't stop praying for them. No matter how lost they are, the chains could come off through prayer. Amen? Don't stop praying for them. Keep praying for those that have chains on them, because prayer could deliver them from those chains. I went to a Billy Graham School of Evangelism. That's what brought us to the Carolinas in the first place. I was pastoring up in Wisconsin, and we went to the Cove area up there in North Carolina. We did a whole school of evangelism with Billy Graham. This is, 35-plus years. No, not that many. But it was 20-some years ago, probably 25-plus years ago. And I'll never forget, one of the workshops we went to was by Charlie Riggs. He was one of Billy Graham's main teammates. And the whole session was on prayer. And the whole session was talking about the power of prayer to rescue people and set people free. And it caught my ear, and I was very attentive during that workshop because I had had a dad for 30-some years that was stuck in alcoholism. And I've been praying for him all my Christian life. God set him free. And I remember what Charlie Riggs said. He said, hey, listen, don't quit praying for those people that are stuck and are in bondage or something, because listen, I prayed for my dad for 54 years. And I had the privilege, he said, on his deathbed to lead him to Christ and pray a sinner's prayer with him right before he died. But it took 54 years. That's why Jesus says, ask and you shall receive. Literal Greek, it's keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking. Amen? It sets the chains, breaks the chains. Okay, so his chains fall off his hands, verse 8, and the angel said to Peter, gird yourself up, put on your sandals, and he did so. And he said to him, wrap your cloak around you, follow me. And he went out, continued to follow. This is Peter following the angel. And he did not know what was being done by the angel was real, but thought he was seeing a vision. And when they had passed through the first and second guard, they came to the iron gates that led into the city, which opened for them by itself, and they went out. And they went along one street, and immediately an angel departed from Peter. And when Peter came to himself, realized it wasn't just bad pita bread and a dream, he says, when he came to himself, and he said, whoa, now I know for sure that the Lord has sent forth his angel and rescued me from the hand of Herod and from all the Jewish people we were expecting. So prayer changes things, number one, because it provides peace in the midst of crisis. Prayer changes things because it provides deliverance to those who are in captivity and bondage. Prayer changes things, thirdly, because it provides supernatural intervention. Do you see? Church is praying, and what does God do in response to the prayers? He sends an angel. And the angel comes, in response to their prayers, the angel comes, and the angel knocks off the chains of Peter, and then says, Peter, come on, come on. And then he takes him out, and he delivers him to complete safety. Prayer changes things because it provides supernatural intervention. I love Tony Evans. He put it this way. The quote should be up on the screen. It says, prayer is the divinely authorized method of accessing heavenly authority for earthly intervention. I'll say that again. That's a great quote. Prayer is the divinely authorized method of accessing heavenly authority for earthly intervention. William MacDonald, in his commentary, put it this way. The force of earnest, halting prayer was mightier than King Herod and mightier than hell. Amen, church? Amen. Probably one of the greatest answers of prayer I've had personally in my life was in my second year of seminary. Some of you heard this story before, but I'll tell it anyways. I was in my second year of seminary, and I felt led that I was supposed to plant a church. But I needed to get through my 3 years of seminary in order to plant the church after my third year of seminary. And so I knew that I had to do summer school after my second year of seminary to graduate in 3 years to plant a church after that. And so I remember calling my dad, and my dad was concerned about my financial status because I was broke. And I said, Dad, here's the deal. I'm going to do summer school this summer so I get done in 3 years so then I could go out and plant the church that God's called me to plant. My dad read me the riot act. He said, you need to come home and get a construction job again. I'll get you a road construction job. You'll make enough money for your last year of seminary, and then you won't have more debt. Just come home and work. I said, Dad, listen. Dad, I'll pray about it. Talk about throwing gas on a fire. He's like, what are you doing? Talk about praying about it. Just get home and work. He hung up the phone on me like that. Dad, I'll pray about it. So you know what I did? What did I do? I prayed about it. And I did. I fervently, like the church here, I was fervently praying, God, please provide so I could go to summer school this summer, get done in 3 years, and plant the church you called me to do. Please provide. And I prayed for days. Then one day in Fuller Seminary library, one of my good friends from the campus walked by. His name was Kent Norell. And Kent Norell was one of those guys that was like genius level, very smart guy. And he's whistling. He didn't normally whistle. And he's smiling. And he's got all this joy. And I'm in the dumps because I'm broke. And I said, Kent, what's going on with you, man? What are you so happy about? He goes, I just won $36,000 on a game show in Hollywood, and it's going to pay for all the rest of my seminary. I said, let's go outside and talk. Went outside the Fuller Seminary library, and I talked to him for 30 minutes. And he basically strategically gave me the whole way to get on the show, get through. There's three different auditions until you get to the producer's audition, and then how to get through that. And there's about 600 people a week that would go through auditions. Only 18 people would get on the show. And then he gave me the strategy of how to win on the show. So I went through the whole week of auditions. I got on the show that Saturday. And I won just enough money to pay for the last year of seminary. And then after a whole day of taping and stuff, I got home. It was after midnight, and I called my dad. I woke him up like the angel woke up Peter. I called my dad, and I said, Dad, guess what? And he said, what? You're waking me up. And I said, I just got on this, he didn't even know I was on the game show. I just got on a game show in Hollywood, and I made just enough money to pay for my whole last year of seminary. And you know what? He hung up the phone and said, you got to be kidding me. Boom, like this. But I did go home that summer. And when I went home that summer, you know what happened? Every one of my dad's friends that I met said, your dad's been telling us for the last 2 months, I don't know about my son's Christianity, but this prayer thing, there's something to that. And so, for you to believe I'm telling you the truth here, I'm going to show you like a 30-second video back to 1985 when I was on the game show. Lights, camera, action, show
us. Our second player is John Hoppe. All right, John.
Great, Peter, great.
Where are you from, John?
I'm from Chicago, Illinois originally, and I was born in Anchorage, Alaska.
Ooh, cold.
Oh, yeah. I hate cold weather, too.
You don't like it? Yeah. That's why you're in California, right?
You betcha.
All right, well, send the whammies up to Alaska, and maybe we can all enjoy the weather and the money. Okay, John, good luck to you.
It's after I won.
Of $6,858. Congratulations.
All right, turn it off quick, please.
John,
true testimony. True testimony. It really, hey, who was that guy? He had hair. But God answers prayers. Amen? He supernaturally intervenes in response to our prayers. And it was amazing. I'm still stunned that happened. Anyways, let's go on to our story. Verse 12. Come on, back to the word. And it says, and when he realized this, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, who was also called Mark, where many were gathered together and were praying. And when he knocked at the door of the gate, a servant girl named Rhoda, Rhoda means rose, came to answer. And when she recognized Peter's voice, because of her joy, she did not open the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter was standing in front of the gate. And look what they said. And they said to her, what? This is comical. Peter's been delivered. He's been set free. Supernatural intervention. He comes to the gate. He's knocking on the door. Rhoda answers the door, opens the gate, and she slams the door in his face. They go, why don't you tell the guy's praying? The people are praying. And they say, oh, Lord, deliver Peter. Set him free. Rescue him. Rescue him. And what do they say? She comes in and says, Peter's been rescued. What do they say? Rhoda, you're out of your mind. You're distracting us here. We're praying. Leave us alone. And she keeps, he's out there. Well, it must be an angel. It must be an angel going on with the story. And they continue. Peter, outside the gate, says he continued knocking. And when they opened the door, they saw Peter and were amazed. But motioning to him with his hand to be silent, he described to them how the Lord had led him out of the prison. And he said, report these things to James and the brethren. And he departed and went to another place. I like this. You know why I like this? Next point on prayer. Prayer changes things even when we have a lack of faith. So people are praying, but obviously they weren't praying with a lot of faith, were they? Because when the prayer was answered, what they say, you're out of your mind. No way this is happening. But you know what? God is big enough and God is great enough that even when we pray with little faith, prayers can be answered. Jesus said, if you just pray with the faith of a mustard seed, you can move mountains. And I like this too because I can relate to this. Sometimes I'm praying and deep down I'm praying, but I don't really have a lot of faith that's going to happen. And God answers the prayer anyways because that's how great our God is. When we started the bunkhouse where you turn for Christ out here, I went into a panic mode. Because right after we started this $600,000-$700,000 project for the bunkhouse for U Turn for Christ that we're going to pay all cash for, we went into COVID. And I didn't even know, we couldn't take an offering anymore. And I didn't even know if we were going to make it financially as a church because the governor was shutting down the churches. We had to go to drive-up church. I went a little bit in a panic mode, lack of faith. But I prayed. I prayed, God, provide for this bunkhouse. God, do some way of so we don't have to go into debt again. We could pay full cash for it. And I prayed with little faith. And we got towards the end of the project. We still had another $150,000 that we had to pay off to finish to get the final contractors done, everything else. And I was losing some faith. I'm going, how are we going to pay for this? I don't even have a loan on this. We're trying to pay cash for everything. And then I got a phone call. Well, actually, my secretary, Bethany, got a phone call. And I was out of the office. I came back the next day, and she said, hey, this guy from Charleston called, and he's been live streaming, And we're his church because he's been fighting cancer. He can't go physically to church during COVID, but he's watching every Sunday morning. Him and his wife are watching every Sunday morning, every Wednesday night, and he wants the numbers. Because I announced during one of those Sundays, we're building the bunkhouse and pray for that, and we've been praying. And so I said, wants the numbers? What's up with that? He goes, he wants to know what the cost is going to be. And so I called him the next day, and he wants the numbers. And I said, you know what? And he was a wonderful man of God, and his wife both. And they said, this is our church, even though we're 2 hours away, because you have been ministering to us the word through live streaming, and we want to help with the bunkhouse. And I didn't feel led to give him the numbers, because I just said, hey, where God guides, God provides. I just said, hey. He said, what's the numbers? I go, listen, you just give whatever the Lord's calling you to give. And I got a call the next day from his stockbroker. You know what his stockbroker said? My client wants to donate some stock towards the bunkhouse. I go, stock? Okay, whatever. And I had done the numbers. I didn't give him the numbers, but he'd done the numbers that it was you know, going to be about $130 to $140 to finish the project. And he said, I said, what stock? And he gave me the details of the stock. It was good stock, Apple and Costco and Nike. And then I asked the stockbroker, I said, and how much is this stock going to cover for the bunkhouse? I thought it might be $5,000, something like that. And he goes, $150,000. Really? And for weeks after that, I was like these people praying for Peter. I was like stunned. I've been praying, but lack of faith. But God answered my prayers anyways and our prayers anyways. Amen? Amen. That's the power of prayer. Even with little faith, God can do wonderful, awesome things. Let's close up our story right now. It goes now in verse 18. Now when day came, there was no small disturbance among the soldiers as to what could have happened to Peter. And when Herod had searched for him and not found him, he examined the guards and ordered that they be led away to execution, and he went down from Judea to Caesarea and was spending time there. Now he was very angry with the people of Tyre and Sidon, and with one accord they came to him, to Herod, who's in Caesarea now. Having won over Blastus, the king's chamberlain, they're asking for peace because their country was fed by the king's country. And on the appointed day, Herod, having put on his royal apparel, took his seat on the rostrum, began delivering an address to them. And immediately verse 22, and the people kept crying out, the voice of a God, not of a man. And immediately an angel of the Lord struck Herod because he did not give God the glory. And he was eaten by worms, and he died. But notice, verse 24, the word of the Lord continued to grow, be multiplied. And Barnabas and Saul returned from Jerusalem when they had fulfilled their mission, taking along with them John, who is called also Mark. So you get the scene? Peter escaped. Herod needed a vacation. And so he leaves Judea and he goes up to Caesarea. I've been to Caesarea 3 different times on trips to Israel. It's a little resort area. It was actually built by Herod the Great, the grandpa of this Herod. And it was a place that the soldiers could retreat to. There's entertainment there. There's a huge amphitheater right on the water right there. And so Herod says, I need to get out of this chaos. You know, the whole thing that happened with Peter escaping and going past his guards. He goes on vacation to Caesarea. And he gets up and he gives a speech. Now, Josephus from Antiquities, the historian, says this. When he came up to give a speech, his whole royal apparel was silver, made out of silver thread. And he glistened in the midst of the sun. And the people actually saw this glistening on his apparel. He said, this must be a god. And then it says that Herod took that worship. And instead of giving glory to God, he took it for himself. Now, Billy Graham says, you're never more like Satan than when you grab God's glory. We're told in the word of God, I am the Lord, that is my name. This is Isaiah 42:8. I will not give my glory to another, nor my praise to graven images. Psalm 115:1, not to us, O Lord, not to us, but to your name give glory because of your loving kindness, because of your truth. So what does God do to Herod? Destroys him. Lets him to get something that happens, I don't know, it was infection in his intestines or what happened, but basically worms gets in him and he dies right there on the spot. Interesting. Now, there was more than just grabbing God's glory here though too. Romans chapter 12 says, vengeance is mine, I'll repay, says the Lord. And what did Herod do? He killed one of Jesus' best friends. God is a God of love, but he's a God of justice too. And he was bringing justice here to this man that killed James, the first apostle martyred. Interesting. Interesting. But notice too, the beginning of this chapter, what was happening? Beginning of the chapter, if you go back, it's we see that Herod is ruling, right? James is being killed, and Peter is being imprisoned. What's happening by the end of the chapter? Herod's dead. Peter's rescued, and the word of God is ruling. Because I love what it says about the word of God there. The word of the Lord continued to grow and was multiplied, right? So what changed the whole deal? What changed it? Prayer. The church was praying. Hey, when we work, we work. But when we pray, God works. I love that. Again, the prayers of righteous people, man, powerful. They're effective. They avail much. They change things. So three takeaways in closing this morning. Three takeaways. Taking notes. Three takeaways. Number one, realize the importance of prayer. Realize how powerful a weapon you have through prayer. And why do we need to realize the importance of prayer? Because you'll pray more. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. And as you realize how important prayer is, you'll pray more. Second takeaway, make sure you have a daily time. Set aside an appointment with God. I call it a quiet time. Whether it be in the morning or night, whatever, your morning person, night person, choose an appointment every day and don't miss your appointment. Spend time, 15, 20 minutes, just reading the word and praying. Because prayer changes things. And the last thing, last takeaway I want to give you, hey, this is important. Listen, church. Give me your attention. Listen. Don't quit praying for people that are wandering or stuck or have chains. People didn't quit praying for you. Don't quit praying. As Jesus said, keep on asking, keep on seeking, keep on knocking.